warned him not to do that. And when he plunged in, he hit his arm on a big log and he got this sharp pain. And the big boys rushed over to him. They pulled him out of the water and took him all the way home to his mommy. His mother ran him to the ASAP church planter's home. You see, Miss Kydd was a brand new Christian and she didn't know what to do. She gasped out the words, "Church planter Tavon, Tom C just jumped off a log and he was in the water and he got hurt. Should we go to the witch doctor? He can breathe a healing on him." You see, that was the only thing she knew to do. Church planter Tavon breathed and shook his head and gently said, "Miss Kydd, we are Christians and we go to the true healer. We go to God. We pray to Jesus and he'll help us." Tumsi was still crying softly because of the pain in his arm, but when he heard the words, "Jesus will help," hope came into his heart. Mr. Tavon, the church planter, and the elders knelt down and prayed for Tumsi. Miss Kydd was so happy that she didn't need to give any money to the elders for animal sacrifices or payment like she would have had to do if she went to the shaman, the witch doctor. Miss Kydd is poor, and that would have been hard for her. After praying, Mr. Tavon felt impressed that he should get Tumsi checked in the hospital. "People like you give to ASAP for the poor fund so we can help little boys like Tumsi go to the hospital when they need it." So they drove on a motorcycle a long way to a big hospital. And when he got there, Tumsi was scared, but he remembered that Jesus was going to heal him. The doctor examined him with an x-ray and put it in a sling. And Tumsi couldn't run after the chickens and animals and run with the big boys after that. He had to rest and go slow. But you know what? Jesus answered those prayers, and 10 days later, he was healed and back running around the village as fast as ever. Praise the Lord! He was a bit more careful, though, to stay out of the water. This experience helped Tumsi and his mom understand who to turn to when they're in trouble. When you're in trouble, when you're hurt or disobedient, will you too remember to turn to Jesus? He's the true healer, not only of her arms, but of hearts too. One of my favorite verses is Malachi 4:2. "But to you who fear his name, the Son of Righteousness will arise with healing in his wings, and you will go out and grow fat like stall-fed calves." You know how healthy calves do? They jump around with playfulness and joy. I'm sure Jesus was so happy to heal Tumsi so he could run around again. And he's also happy to help and heal you too. Let's thank Jesus for being a true healer. Dear Lord, thank you for healing Tumsi, and thank you for the kids that are watching this video. Please help them with whatever problems they have. In Jesus' name, amen. Because Jesus is coming soon, now more than ever, mission matters.
Alex attended the only Seventh-day Adventist school on the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. These islands sit in the Bay of Bengal. They are part of India, even though they sit closer to Southeast Asian countries of Myanmar and Indonesia. Alex has fond memories of learning at this island school.
I love teachers in this school because they teach me very kindly.
The school's curriculum is based on the Bible. They only have 3 teachers, but what they lack in quantity, they make up for in quality of teaching.
The school starts with prayer. Then after that, before they are going to classes, it starts with the some story related to Bible. So that they, after telling that, they will teach them one memory verse every day.
This school has a positive reputation in the community. Every parent wants to see their child succeed, which is why Alex's parents trusted the Adventist school to educate their son. Unfortunately, the school only offers nursery and preschool levels for kids. The students have to look for other education options once they finish preschool.
Last year we had 32 students. Among those, 9 were graduated. That means they finished UKG, upper KG, then went to other school because we don't have the higher studies. Then primary school we don't have.
At his new school, Alex was required to attend class on the Sabbath. But thanks to his prior education, he was able to defend his faith to his teacher.
I told to my teacher that the fourth commandment is we have to follow the holy Sabbath. So I have to go to the Sabbath because I will obey to God. So I told to my teacher that if I don't listen to my Lord, then how is it possible to listen to you? So I have to go to church.
After discussions between the teacher and Alex's parents, Alex now has the Sabbath off. Alex is not alone in facing the challenge of attending school on Sabbath. Other Adventist students face the same problem. That's why this quarter, we can help expand the Adventist school beyond preschool all the way through high school.
Please pray for our church ministry in Andaman Nicobar Islands. All our church members praying for an Adventist school in a higher level, that is till up to high school, because all Adventist children should continue their education here itself without any problem, without any difficulties.
A portion of your 13th Sabbath offering this quarter will help build the new Seventh-day Adventist English school in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, providing a higher level of education so more people can learn about the love of Jesus.
Thank you so much for supporting us through 13th Sabbath School mission offerings.
Thank you. Good morning. Sabbath blessings. Okay, let me get some reciprocal feedback. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Okay. Nice to have everyone here. Well, from my perspective, all roads lead to the Fort Saskatchewan Seventh-day Adventist Church, but there's many other wonderful, meaningful churches to worship in the Edmonton area too, and we all are congregating in concert with the great congregation in heaven and those in this time zone that are coming together and entering into the attitude of worship and praise. Some announcements quickly for our church members only. The quarterlies are on the table, so make sure you take one. Put your name on the quarterly, just in case you leave it laying around so we know who it belongs to in the future. Also, our seminar is underway. Who's been watching the seminar online? Some of you have. Okay, well, that's good. And it's a great little resource, an extension, a tentacle to be able to share those presentations with people now that we're testing out our live stream equipment. Now, in 1 month from now, we have the Fort Saskatchewan Trade Show coming up, okay? And we've got the weekend of April 19 to 21st. So I'm going to hand out a clipboard here. If you want to help out with the trade show, we've been doing this now for 10 years. And we're going to make a balloonatic out of you. You're going to stand at the booth, and you don't have to make balloons. You can just smile and ask people if they want to enter a draw for $200 worth of a grocery certificate, or you can make a balloon animal for them. We've got a few of us now who are seasoned, mediocre balloonatics making balloon animals for the kids, and we get hundreds and hundreds of kids come by the table, and we give out thousands of pieces of literature. So if you want to help out, I'm going to pass out these clipboards, and it's the trade show hours are on Friday, and then Sabbath and Sunday. You can take a look at the hours. If you put your name on there that you'd like to just come and help out at the trade show, we'll take a look at the schedule to see where she can best allocate the hours, etc. Lise and Anne, in particular, will be there on the Sabbath for the first few hours while we're having church service, and then I and whoever else wants to come over there and relieve them. Because it's really busy on Sabbaths, on Saturdays there. That's the busiest time from 10 in the morning. I think it's 10 till 5. So from 10 till about 2 o'clock, it's just mayhem. Lots of people, lots of kids in that too. And we're making balloon animals for all the kids. So, and giving out literature. So let me pass these around. And we're going to be finishing our seminar. We're at night number 8 on Monday, the 666 and the Mark of the Beast, part 2. And then after that, we're going to lighten the schedule load a bit, and we will continue on every Tuesday night for the next several weeks into the spring months, and then complete our seminar progression. Also, I need to mention, so we have a new pastor. You knew that, right? Pastor Vladimir Melis from the Ukraine. He begins next week, April 1st. So I haven't heard from him yet, but here's the news. So they're going to be giving an installation Sabbath welcoming in Smoky Lake on April 6th. So until the pastor contacts me, we'll talk about his preaching schedule and when he wants to come and visit with us. But on April 6th, he is going to be preaching in Smoky Lake. There will be a representative from the conference office, and we are invited. Those who are of our churches, Boyle and Fort Saskatchewan, are invited to come out and be part of that church service. There'll probably be a potluck dinner and just a celebrational atmosphere. So for those who would like to go out there, I won't be out there. I'll wait till he gets a hold of me, and then we'll welcome him with open arms here. But if anybody would like to go to Smoky Lake on April 6th, you're welcome to do so. So just want to make sure that you have heard that in earshot. And next week we have communion service. So Meryl, did you get my text message this morning? You did. Okay, so next week is communion service. So you and Randy for our deacon duties. If you can keep that in mind, and then we have our deaconesses on duty, and just keep that in mind, next week is a go for communion service. And I think that is all we need for our announcements. If you do get online to see the latest Adventist news, Alberta Adventist news, we'll be getting the magazines here probably this week in the mail, and we'll make them available to you. But if you get online, you'll be able to see we have a little bit of a report for Fort Saskatchewan with our baptisms that we had recently, etc. And it's kind of exciting to see that there's an acknowledgement of that too. So why don't we take a moment and just shake the hands of the folks next to you, and let's just welcome people to church as we get ready for our church service.
Father God, we come today to worship and to praise your holy name. We come not because there's anything good in us, but because you are good, because you are merciful, you're long-suffering. You are our Father, and we worship you. You have promised that when we come together in your name, you will be there to bless. So bless us today, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Would the congregation please rise?
Sabbath. Look at all the kids I have today. That's better than the last time. But I have a really good story here. And actually, it comes from Adventist Family Ministries. So I'm going to start off this story. And so I have boys and girls today. That's nice. Okay. Now, it's called Mother's Hands. A young mother laid her baby girl to sleep in her cradle. "I'll just go to the neighbors for a minute to visit," she thought to herself. "I haven't had time to talk to her for such a long time." But while she and the neighbor were chatting, the city fire alarm sent a chill through them both. "Ooh." "Don't worry," said the neighbor. "Most likely it's only a grass fire. There are lots of them at this time of year. I'm sure the fire isn't anywhere near here." "But listen," said the mother. "I think I hear the fire engine coming this way. Look, people are running down the street, running toward my house." Without another word, she dashed into the street and ran with the gathering crowd. Then she saw it. If I can have the first picture, please, Pastor. Her own house was on fire. Smoke and flames were already pouring through the roof. "My baby," she cried frantically. "My baby." The crowd was thick around the house, but she pushed and shoveled until she reached the door. A fireman stopped her and said, "You can't go in there. You will be burned." But the mother cried, "Let me go, let me go," as she broke free and dashed into the flaming house. She knew just where to go. Running through the smoke and flames, she seized her precious baby, then turned to make her way out. But by now, the smoke made it very hard to see and breathe. Nearly overcome, she swayed and fell, and would not have made it out of the house safely if a fireman had not picked her up and carried her out. Oh, yeah, it's terrible, isn't it? Yeah. I was worried about putting the picture up there. Might be some bad you know. But anyways, what a cheer went up as they appeared. Baby Marjorie was not hurt at all, but the poor mother's hands were terribly burned. Kind friends took care of the baby while the ambulance took her to the hospital. The doctors did their best, but her hands were terribly scarred. Years later, when Marjorie had grown, she suddenly noticed something she had not noticed before. Her mother's hands were so ugly. "Why are your hands so ugly?" she asked her mother when they were alone. Tears filled her mother's eyes as she remembered how frightened she was the day the house burned with Marjorie asleep and unaware of the danger. "Have I said something wrong?" Marjorie asked when she saw the tears. "No, my dear," replied her mother. "But there's a story I need to tell you." Then she told Marjorie the story of the fire. She told how the people tried to hold her back, how the firemen tried to stop her, how she battled the flames to rescue her, how she fell and how they were rescued. Then she held out her scarred hands for Marjorie to see. "They are ugly in a way, aren't they?" Mother said softly. "For me, the only thing that mattered was to save your life." Now is Marjorie's turn to shed a few tears. "Oh, Mother," she cried, "you must love me so much. These are the most beautiful hands in all the world." Do you know that there are hands that were hurt for you? The hands of Jesus. Soldiers drove great nails through his hands and hung him on a cross to die. So you could go to heaven. Even when he comes again, the marks made by those nails will still be there for all eternity. If you ask him, he will show them to you. When you see them, you will know for sure how much Jesus loves you. Loves us all. That's why he was going to have those marks on his hands forever. Because he died for our sins. So isn't that a love, such a great love as what he has, what our Heavenly Father has for us? Right? And we will see, and we will have perfect bodies. We will have perfect bodies, but that's the marks he's going to have forever. So that's the story. So would anyone like to pray?
Heaven, thank you for this wonderful day. Thank you that we got to go to church today. Thank you that you made us. Thank you that we have a house. Thank you that you did lots of things for us and forgive our sins. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Thank you so much. You can all go back to your seats now.
Jesus died for all the children.
Well, it is now time to test our Bible knowledge. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil.
Okay.
Where? Oh, that's awesome. You folks really did well on this verse. So where is that found? Oh, Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 to 7. Proverbs 3, 5 to 7. Right on. Awesome. Please stand with us.
Those harmonies.
Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me deep the healing cleansing blood. Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Hey, ladies only.
Just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and
all together now.
And I know that thou art with me.
All together now.
Bye.
together now.
The Lord is my life, my joy and my song, the day and my night, leading along. The Lord is my life, my joy and my song, my day and my night, He leads me along.
Amen. Sing, ladies, hum. Switch it around.
My weakness in mercy He covers with power, and walking by faith He upholds me.
All together now. Together now.
The Lord is my life, my all and in all. There is in His sight no darkness at all. He is my Redeemer, my Savior and King. He sits and with angels His praises I sing. The Lord is
sound beautiful.
The Lord is my light, my joy and my song, my day and my night, He leads me along.
Amen. What are you thankful for this morning? Everything. We can't top that one. Be specific. Everything? What else are you thankful for? Health, good health, yeah. Yeah. Waking up, yeah, yeah. The beauty of awareness, yeah.
To be here.
Okay, you got that? His annoying and troublesome dog, Toby. He's thankful for Toby. Amen. Toby's your heavenly sandpaper, too. That's right. Well, I will interject. I hope you're happy with them, because in our backyard, in the front yard, we have six of them. I came home from a walk there last spring, and I had six of them sitting on my front lawn, and they were munching on all my flowers. And I was so thankful. So I come up with a plan B, and I still don't have a plan B yet on how to keep those little bunnies from munching. That's right, yeah. Francis? Yes, you got a hard cast on there, do you? Okay, so you're down for the count for a few weeks. And you just had a wrist situation going on. The other one. Oh, man, that's, wow.
Last fall, you broke the other wrist, right?
Yeah.
Just before Christmas. Oh, my. So that's only four months ago. 3-4 months.
Jennifer, you can come forward. I'm thankful for you folks that you're here today. So thankful.
Amen.
Praise God for that. Our offering today is for Alberta Advance, so that is an important offering. And Jennifer, you can probably just grab this microphone. And Lise, do you have a microphone in your hand? You don't. You're just vacating. Okay.
Dear Heavenly, dear Heavenly Father, glory. Dear Heavenly Father, please bless the offerings that we give, and may we give generously and with a willing heart. And thank you for another beautiful Sabbath day. And thank you for your protection during the week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Didn't have to live the glory of heaven, but you became a simple man. You didn't have to serve the poor and afflicted, but you touched and healed their brokenness. No greater love has been given. You became the ultimate sacrifice. Created me the heart of a servant. Let this be my soul's desire. Show me how to love in the true meaning of your word. Teach me to sacrifice, expecting nothing in return. I want to give my life away, becoming more like you each and every day. My words are not enough, please show me how to love. I saw a bruised and battered woman with her angry children on the street. Then I heard you ask in the still voice, what have you done for the least of these? Lord, consume me with a burning fire that melts away my complacency. Then let me be moved with love and compassion, that someone will find a way in me. Show to love in the true meaning of your word. Teach me to sacrifice, expecting nothing in return. I want to give my life away, becoming more like you each and every day. My words are not enough, please show me. Open up my eyes that I might really see more and more and more of you and less of me. By loving the unlovable and touching the untouchable,
it's pretty loud. He was having a problem with drugs, was it? Oh boy. Peter? Pastor?
A seminar prayer request. We've had a couple requests come in. I won't mention them. This is confidential, but they've been placed on our envelopes and we want to lift them up. Our seminar prayer request.
Okay.
And the seminar at that, too.
Yeah. Jill? That's your niece? Vince? What's his name? Brendan? Yes.
I have two prayer requests. One is from my co-worker's husband who has problems with his son. He dragged himself north. He's not very much medical care there. His name is Master. And for Elizabeth, so that she can find a suitable place to be.
Okay. Eugene. Stuart? Sherry? Your grandkids? Father? Oh my gosh. Yeah, it's hard. Okay. And I'm going back to work tomorrow after my knee replacement, so just gonna have...
How long have you been away from work?
5.5 months. Yeah, 5.5 months, so going back 4 hours modified and take it from there. Yeah. Okay, so I guess that's everybody for now. Thank you. Father, we come to you today in this building of worship, on bended knee as we come and pray to you, Lord. There's so many concerns and health issues and mental issues and strife and heartache and pain on this list, Lord. Not just from this set of prayers that we want to pray about, but throughout this world, Lord, there's so much pain and suffering, and we know you're coming very, very soon, Lord. We can just see everything happening in this world today, the signs of the times that we are into, that we know that you are near your coming to gather up your children, as we want to all be there, Lord. When you appear, Lord, we want to look up to the sky and meet you up in the clouds of your heavenly angels, Lord. Lord, the people on this list, we pray. There's so many, Lord, and you know what's on this list. I'm not going to go through it. It's a long one. But we know that prayers make a difference. More prayer, more power. And we're all here together now in prayer. So, Lord, I ask for your blessings upon these people that need your help right now, and the silent prayers that are out there, and the ones that weren't brought forward, the ones that are too many to mention, but you know them all. God, we just ask that you please touch every individual. We are your children. You are the great physician. You send us your comforter, the Holy Spirit, to direct us in what we need to do and how to follow you, Lord. Help us to use our minds wisely in making the good and proper decisions. And to, as I always say to my children, when you do good for God, he's smiling upon us. When you're not doing good for God, the devil is laughing. And who do we want to go with? We want to go with you, Lord. We want to be in your heavenly kingdom one day where there's no pain and suffering, no sorrow of any kind. We want to be able there to just worship you and grab onto your legs and just bow down to your feet, Lord. Because you are the one and only way of true everlasting life. We cherish to be there one day in your heavenly kingdom, Lord. So thank you, Lord. We ask that you please respect this prayer and guide us throughout this continuing service, and to put the proper words in the speaker's mouth, and that we all leave from this building today that we are impacted to do what is good for you, Lord. So thank you, Lord, for hearing this prayer, and please forgive us of our sins. In the name of Jesus, amen.
All rise for the reading of the scripture. The scripture this morning is found in Matthew 6, 9-13. Yeah, Matthew 6:9-13. I trust that it's found. Okay, in this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead unto temptation, but deliver us from evil, from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated.
cross, oh bless that sweet exchange. Never let me be moved from this divine retreat. For the Spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. The Spirit is willing, but my flesh is weak. My Spirit.
Good morning, church. It is good to be here. I've been truly blessed being here this morning. I attend a church that's a little bit bigger than this one. We have a seating capacity of about 1,100. So the building is big. And when we're in there, you don't feel the love like you feel the love this morning. Being here, so it's really good to be here. I don't know if I shared with you last time I was here, I have a hearing problem. So in that big building, everything bounces all over, you know, and I don't hear very well, but this morning was really good being in this church. And your singing really touched me. The praise team, thank you very much. The Lord is my light, my joy, and my strength. It was good. And the special music, thank you so much. I was so blessed by hearing that. I want to tell you, your praise and thanksgiving that I witnessed all morning from Sabbath school right through, it's amazing. You know, God is so good. He blesses us in so many, so many ways. Pastor Darrell, those rabbits, you know, it was a blessing that you could feed them, that you could help God feed them. Because you know, you didn't make one of those flowers grow. It was He who did it, right? It was God who. God provides. God provides. And I heard a theme all through the morning, you know. When it was really cold a few weeks ago, I was parked behind a building in Edmonton, and a bunch of songbirds, I don't know what time, but a whole bunch just came and, you know, sat around there. And there was a metal pipe that was part of the east rough downdraft coming out of the building. It was disconnected. And those birds would come and they would sit right on there because some warm air was coming out. And one would sit there for a few minutes and the other one, they were just straight places. And I sat there and I said, like, how do they know to do these things? And, you know, why was this pipe disconnected? And it was really cold. And I could see that. And not one bird tried to manipulate the spot. It would come, it would start another one and another one. It's amazing how God takes care of His creatures. God is so good. And that's what I heard all morning being here. You blessed me more than you could imagine or thought you would. So I don't know if I need to say anything. Maybe we could have the closing song. Because it was really, really good being here. I am so happy that Pastor Darrell invited me again. I've been here a few times. The last couple of times I was here, my wife was not with me. She's here with me today. Amen. So I'm glad that she's here. Her name is Vanda. Now, we we attend Christ the Way, Seventh-day Adventist Church. We've been there from the beginning. And Velda, it's nice to see you. Somebody, I didn't notice they were there today. Good to see you guys. They were once part of our church over there, so it's good to see them. But God has been good to us there. You know, our membership is growing fast. Our attendance is around 250 now. And coming out of COVID, we only had about 40. So God has been good. And we are so grateful for his many, many blessings. Today I chose a topic that I did not realize was such a vast topic. The Lord's Prayer is indeed very impactful. Jesus is the master teacher. And when he gave that model prayer, he packed so much in there. And when you read it on the surface, you don't see everything that he's trying to convey until you start to take it apart, line by line. The entire plan of salvation is right in the Lord's Prayer. The entire great controversy between good and evil is outlined in God's Prayer. The way he takes care of you and me every day is in God's Prayer. It's a reminder of all these things that God does for us, that God has done, is doing, and will continue to do for us. We could spend all day talking about the Lord's Prayer, but we only have a few minutes, so I'm going to try and go fast. I'm going to try and touch the highlights, and we'll go from there. Now, before Jesus gave the Lord's Prayer, he made some statements in Scripture that kind of sets the context for his prayer. So if you have your Bibles, let's turn to Matthew 7, and we'll look at verses 9 to 11. Matthew 7, 9 to 11. Remember, this is just after he gave the Lord's Prayer. He's telling this story. And it's one about, I'll just read. 9 to 11 says, or what man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, who is in heaven, give good things to those who ask him? God wants to give us good things. Matthew 6, 8. Let's read that one. Verse 8 says, therefore, it's talking about how we pray. And this is just before he gives the Lord prayer. Therefore, do not pray like them, for your Father knows the things that you have need of before you ask him. Before you ask him, he knows. You could come with full confidence knowing that he wants to give you good things and he knows what you need. He knows exactly what you need and he wants to give you good things. So when you come to God in prayer, you could come with full confidence knowing that he's going to answer. Let's look at another two verses, Luke 18, 1 to 8. Luke 18, 1 to 8, a little more context to the Lord's Prayer. He spoke a parable to them that men always ought to pray and not to lose heart. And I'm just going to paraphrase this one. I'm not going to read it. It's a story about, we all know this story, about the unjust judge and this lady who comes to him and say, avenge my adversaries. And he wouldn't, and she comes back, and then he says, you know what, I'm just going to do it because she would never let me rest. She's going to come and come and come again. Was he just right? Let's look at the other one, the final one, and then I'll talk about Luke 11. Luke 11, 5 to 13. Which of you shall have a friend and go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine has come to me on his journey and I have nothing to set before him. And he will answer from within and say, do not trouble me. The door is shut. My children and myself, we are in bed. I cannot give this to you. I say to you, though he will not rise up and give him because he is his friend, yet because of his persistence, he will rise up and give him as many as he needs. Because of his persistence, he would rise up and give him as many as he needs. Then I'm going to drum down from verse 11. We're ready with that. Verse 13. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? Now this is, again, just after he gives the pattern prayer. How much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? Be persistent in prayer. He wants to give you good gifts. Above all, he wants to give you the gift of the Holy Spirit. That's what he's saying. This prayer is about giving the gift of the Holy Spirit to you. Now, I'm not a preacher, and I don't know why Pastor Darrell asked me to come and preach, but I'm not a preacher. So today, we're just going to talk about the Lord's Prayer and see what we could gather out of it. Our Father. It begins with our Father. Now the Jews, when they heard that word, our Father, the first thing that comes to their mind is, we're Abraham's children. Abraham is our father. Our Father. But this time he's not Father Abraham. Our Father who art in heaven. I don't know if you had a good relationship with your father, but I am number 5 of 10 children. I don't think my father paid notice to me too many times. He's got 10 kids, and I'm number 5. You know, his first child was a boy, and he had lots of hope and plans for that guy. Then he had some daughters, and he had me. I'm number 5, and then he had 5 more kids. So sometimes I felt like, you know, nobody sees me. I'm just, you know. But one thing I do know is my dad loves me. He never told me once that he loved me, but I know he loved me. Different people have different relationships with their father. But Jesus is saying here today, our Father. He doesn't use the same word as someone would use to say our father Abraham. The word he uses here for father is daddy. My dad. Our father, our daddy. Okay. Notice he doesn't say, my Father. He wants us to say, our Father. Why our Father? Why our Father and not my Father? He is my Father, but he's our Father. He's our Father, all of us. We're all his children. When we recognize that he is our Father, then we could love one another. Amen. I love my siblings because we all have the same Father. All of us in this room have the same Father. So we ought to love one another. And we ought to pray for one another like you did this morning. And we ought to remember each other in all our struggles, in all our difficulties, in all our problems. He is our Father. What kind of Father is he? Jesus painted another picture about his Father. You know, he told the story of the prodigal son. The young man came to his dad and he said, to put it in plain English, I would really prefer you were dead so I could get my inheritance. But you're not dead, but give it to me anyway. Because in that culture, you could only receive your inheritance once your parents die. He wants his now, so he's wishing his dad was dead. And he goes away and he spends it and all sorts of immoral stuff. And one day he wakes up and comes to his senses and he comes back home. And on his way home he said, I would return to my father and I would say, Father, forgive me. I am no longer worthy to be called your son, so make me one of your hired servants. But as he's coming home, his father sees him afar off, runs to him and greets him, falls on his shoulder and hugs him. And when the young man tries to say, I'm no longer worthy, the father stops him. He doesn't let him say, I'm no longer worthy to be your son. He says, you are my son. Amen. Bring the ring and the robe. Kill the fatted calf. Let's rejoice, my son. That's the kind of father we have. You're not his son because of anything you could do or say or accomplish. Or what. You're his son unconditionally. You are his child. He is our father. He's not like an earthly father. He is in heaven. Many of us, maybe not in this room, but many, many, many of us have had bad experiences with our fathers. That's an earthly father, but a heavenly father doesn't matter. What you've done, where you've been, how long you've been there, he wants to be your father. He wants to be your daddy. He wants to be someone you could come to and pour out your heart as you would to your father. Hallowed be thy name. Hallowed be thy name. When we pray and if we say, hallowed be thy name, are we asking God to make his name holy? Or is his name already holy? He's already holy. There's nothing we could do to make it holy. But at first glance, it looks like we're asking God to be holy. But he is holy. He's always been holy, and he will always be holy. There are some verses in Scripture that describes the scene in heaven, like Isaiah, you know, talks about that vision Isaiah had. In the year that King Uzziah died, he says, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, sitting on his throne. And the angels, describe the angels, how they were, and, you know, the train and all that stuff. But he says, the angels were singing one to the other, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is filled with his glory. He is holy. It's always been holy. In Revelation, John saw the same thing. He said, night, these creatures never cease to say, holy, holy, holy. So God is always holy. So what is Jesus saying when we should pray? Hallowed be thy name. My name is Leroy Kydd. So my father's name is Morris Kydd. I have his name. In these days, you know, a name represented your character. Jacob's name was changed from Jacob to Israel because its character was changed. Abraham's name was changed from Abraham to Abraham. So name represents the character. We have God's name. We should have his character. Hallowed be thy name. He's saying, our lives should be sanctified. They should be holy. They should represent a holy God. Hallowed be your name in my life. Hallowed be thy name. God is holy. Our Sabbath School lesson this morning talks about praise and worship. So when we pray, hallowed be your name, and we should live lives that exemplify a holy God. We should give thanks and praise for all his goodness, for everything that he has done, is doing, and will continue to do in our lives. You already talked this morning about how many things we have to be grateful for. So when we come in prayer and we say, hallowed be your name, we bring our praise and adoration, our thanksgiving for all the good things that God has done for us. You know, he knows how many hairs are left in my head. He knows of every sparrow that fell today. He woke us up this morning and brought us here. The equilibrium in the universe, the pull between the moon and the sun and the stars, is so delicate. If one thing goes off balance, the whole thing would collide. He keeps it in balance every day. It's a finely tuned machine that has to be kept just right. If we were a few thousand miles closer to the sun, we would all perish. And if we were further, every plant will die. It has to be just right. And he keeps it just right every day. Hallowed be his name. He's the one who does this thing for us. Why does he want us to hallow his name? He wants us to remember all these things that God does for us. Because the more we remember, the more we praise. The more we remember, the more praise and thanks we have to give. There are stories in Scripture that demonstrate that, you know, when difficulties come, they go back and say, remember how God has led. Remember what God has done. Remember how he brought us through the Red Sea. Remember this. He wants us to remember all the good things that he has done for us. We must hallow his name. Thy kingdom come. Thy kingdom come. I don't know about you, but every day when I get up, I like to know what the news was from last night. What happened? You know? Did the Ukrainians had some advantage over the Russians? What's up in the Middle East? There was a terrorist attack in Russia. Every day there's something, and you know this is not the way it was supposed to be. Thy kingdom come. But Jesus wasn't talking about earthly kingdom. This is not a prayer for Jesus to return and set up his kingdom. This whole Lord's Prayer was given in the present tense, present continuous. He's talking about today. Thy kingdom come today. What does it mean for his kingdom to come? Thy kingdom come. We live in a country, we have a king, you know. His name is King Charles III. And he kind of represents, I don't know how to explain it, but they say he represents the crown, which means all the people, everything that we agree to, as to how we're going to treat one another, what our laws are going to be, you know, all those things. How we're going to live with one another. That's the agreement we have as a country. We're not going to steal. We're not going to kill. We're not going to hurt others. You know, we're going to take care of the needy. That's the kingdom in which we live. He's the crown of this kingdom. So, thy kingdom come, he's talking about the principles of God's kingdom coming into our lives today. We want to live today under the rules and principles of God's kingdom. Thy kingdom come into our lives today. Thy will be done. Now that's a tough one, you know. That's a big one. Thy will be done. What's God's will? If somebody asks you, what's God's will, what's one of the first things that come to your mind?
Love everybody.
Love. God is love.
Love thy neighbor as thyself.
Love God. Love others as yourself. These are all God's will. He's not willing that any should perish, but everybody should come to repentance. These are God's will. Well, how about God's will for your life? That's a little bit more tricky, yeah? Jeremiah says, speaking when he wrote to the children of Israel in captivity, he says, God says, I have plans for you. See, I know the plans I have for you. Plans to bless you, prosper you, and give you a great future. God have plans for you. God has plans for this church in Fort Saskatchewan. sometimes our plans and our will gets in the way of his plans and his will. You know, Pastor Darrell, I sat on church boards now. This is the first year I'm not on a church board for more than 40 years.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. That's what I said. You know, we sit down and we make all sorts of plans. And the funny thing is, you know, we usually make the plans before we ask God to bless the plans. We don't ask him what kind of plans we should make. We make the plans and we say, we pray that he would bless these plans. And if we went wrong, change them. Finding God's will sometimes is not easy. Mrs. White says that when she talks about finding God's will, prayer and study and meditation goes hand in hand. Prayer, study, and meditation. Those are the three steps we need to take to find God's will in our lives. We have to wait. Sometimes his will is not revealed too quickly. Sometimes it's difficult. We do not want to do the things he wants us to do. We do not want to wait. We want to make some plans for evangelism. And we kind of don't want to talk about crisis method and crisis method alone. You know, because it takes time. We don't want to go mingle with people, meet their needs, get their confidence, and then invite them to come. We want to just invite them to come. Am I right? We just want to invite them to come. But she said, this is what we should do. God's revealed will, but we don't. Let's just bring John Brasher up, rent a big room, and do some advertising and ask them to come. God's will sometimes is not so easy to follow. And you know, most of the reasons we fail in evangelism and in our personal lives is because we do not wait and follow God's will. So thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I don't know if you ever thought about how God's will is done in heaven, but when God said to those angels, go roll that stone away, I don't think they kind of say, well, you know, do we need some equipment? Do we need, you know, they just went and moved the stones so Jesus could come out of it. You know, Michael said to Gabriel, go help Daniel. He just left. No negotiation, no discussion. In heaven, when God says, this is the way it is, that's the way it is. We know the story of Lucifer. He didn't want God's will. So he had a... But God's will on earth as it is in heaven, what a blessing that would be if we could live our lives like that. Do you ever find yourself negotiating with God? You're faced with a problem, you're faced with some difficulty, and you say, Lord, if you only do this for me, I would do A, B, and C. Now sometimes we try to negotiate. I want to tell you something, God's will is not negotiable. God is merciful, don't get me wrong. He's merciful, full of compassion and love. And once in a while he changes his mind, you know, he said to Moses, I'm gonna wipe out all these people and I'm gonna lose you. And there is a new nation from you. And Moses said, and God said, okay. I would give him another chance. Because he's compassionate. So sometimes when you go against God's will, you may feel guilty, but God is full of compassion. He's full of compassion. Give us this day our daily bread. Before I go to give us this day, I want to just remember one other story that kind of is interested in God's will. Because sometimes, you see, we say, like Gideon, give me a sign. You know, Gideon put out the fleece, say, if it's wet, say, okay, it's wet. But one sign wasn't good enough. So you got to give me another sign. Now it's got to be dry. Then Gideon said, now I know it's your will. Have you ever put out the fleece?
Yes.
Sometimes it's okay to put out the fleece. When you're not certain. When you're making important decisions, it's okay. I think it's okay. But look at what Joshua did. God said, march around Jericho once a day. Just go march. Joshua never asked why. He never said, you know, what's going to happen. They just marched. They could come up with all sorts of reasons why they shouldn't march. Like really, somebody asks you to do something, you don't know what the end result is going to be. You're going to go do it? If you end up doing it, you might do it grudgingly. You know, a story was told of a Chinese immigrant way back in Canadian history. They came over, they brought him over to during the Second World War, I think. And they were digging trenches somewhere in Western Canada. But nobody ever told them why they're digging the trenches. And they did it reluctantly. They didn't give them the all. And they're wondering, why are we just digging these things? And once they found out why they were digging it, they were just gladly digging. See, we, like humans, we are like that. We want to know why we're doing what we're doing. Or we don't want to do it sometimes. It's a human thing. But Joshua marched around. And he marched around. And you know, they could have said, like, these people are going to think we're crazy. You know? They could throw rocks at us from the top of those walls. They could find lots of reasons why, but Joshua just marched around. And then the seventh day, he marched around seven times. And the walls came tumbling down. Sometimes we just have to do God's will because he knows best. Naaman didn't want to go dip in the Jordan. You know? Says the bed of rivers, I could go dip in. Dip. And he was healed. Sometimes we just have to follow God's will. Let me change that. Not sometimes. Always we must follow God's will. We don't have to know how the end or what the end is going to be. Just follow God's will. Give us this day our daily bread. Those passages I read before, one talks about which of us would give our kids a serpent instead of a fish? Randy, do your kids have to beg you for lunch or you guys just make lunch?
It all depends.
You just feed your kids because you know they need to be fed. I understand we have potluck today, right? There's food downstairs. Who provided the food? God did. And you know what else? Who is feeding everybody in Fort Saskatchewan today? God is. Now, you know, when we talk about this, sometimes people say, well, what about all the people who have no food today? Does he provide for them too? He provides. The reason some people don't have food, the same reason some people get sick, the same reason some people get hurt, is because of a curse called sin. That the enemy came and planted on this earth. The one who came to kill, steal, and destroy. That's why some people were hungry. God made provision for everybody to have something to eat. But the world is complicated. We interfere with the process. Things happen. We destroy the earth. We make deserts in places that used to be flourishing with greenery. We destroy the earth. We eat food that makes us sick. God gave us a body that is perfectly capable of healing itself if we treat it right. But we don't, so we get sick. God provides for all our needs. But sin causes all these problems. He gives us every day our daily bread. Every single day. Before we ask. I don't believe Jesus is saying here we need to come to him and say, give us. I think what Jesus is saying here, we have to recognize you are the one who gives us our daily bread. You have given us our daily bread. And we come to him in recognition, thanksgiving, praise. You are the one who gives us all these things. So he feeds us all. Forgive us as we forgive. Interesting, you know, I never thought about this one until this week. Forgive us as we forgive. You know, anyone who comes to Jesus, he forgives their sin. If you accept Jesus and you make him Lord of your life, and you say, I accept your sacrifice for me, he forgives your sin. That's what the scripture says. That's his promise. But Jesus said, forgive us as we forgive. You see, it's because although God wants to forgive every sin, that's what he really wants to do. He doesn't want anybody to perish. He wants to forgive every sin. If we confess, he's faithful and just to forgive. And he forgives. But if we don't want to forgive others, he can't forgive us. So he didn't mention the first forgiveness. He's just talking about this one. Because the audience he was talking to already knew that one. Now he's reminded them that, you know, if you don't forgive, I can't forgive. Remember the question Peter asked? How many times should we forgive? Should we forgive 7 times? No, 70 times 7. He forgives us as we forgive. So when you're a follower of Christ, the only reason you will not receive forgiveness is if you don't give forgiveness. He died for you. He paid the price for every sin you would ever commit. All you got to do is accept the gift. But if you refuse to forgive others, he can't forgive. Important principle in God's kingdom. If you're going to be fair with one another, we have to forgive. We have to forgive one another. Do not lead us into temptation. Do not lead us into temptation. You think he was saying, if we know that God doesn't tempt anybody, James makes that clear. He said, God cannot be tempted and he doesn't tempt anyone. So what is Jesus saying? He lead us not into temptation. Is it a request for God, or is it a statement saying that you are the one who would never lead us into temptation? He never leads us into temptation. And I could say that with full confidence because the next statement that he makes says, you deliver us from evil. And the actual translation is, you are the one who delivers us from the evil one. He delivers us from Satan. He delivers us from the evil one. Let's turn to Isaiah chapter 61. Let me just read the verse there. Isaiah 61. 1-3. Just a reminder, God sent his son. It says, and this is a prophecy about Jesus. It says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to preach the good news, the good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to open and the opening of the prisons to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of God, to comfort all those who mourn. And he goes on to say, to give beauty for ashes and the oil of joy for mourning. He is the one who delivers us from the chains of sin. He delivers us from guilt and shame. He gives us the strength to overcome the devil. He delivers us from the evil one. Without him, we are no match for Satan's attacks. He is the one who delivers us from the evil one. And so we come with prayer and thanksgiving and praise, adoration. This model prayer that God gives reminds us of the whole plan of salvation. The love of the Father, he sent his Son. He accepts us just as we are. He brings us back into his family in fellowship with him. He wants us to learn to trust him in every way, every day. He gives us power to live above sin. He delivers us from the evil one. He forgives all of our sins. The entire plan of salvation is there. And then he says, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. One day, not only will the spiritual kingdom that reigns in our hearts be here, but the actual physical kingdom with all its power and glory would be on earth. You know, our friends in the evangelical arena, some of them believe that, you know, Jesus is going to come and he's going to set up a kingdom in Jerusalem. And there's going to be a period of peace for 1,000 years. Did you know that? They teach that. He's going to reign from Jerusalem. Period of peace for 1,000 years on earth. Well, our Muslim friends teach us the same thing. Okay? They said, Mahdi is going to come. You know who the Mahdi is? That's the Islam Messiah. Okay? He's going to come, and he's going to set up a kingdom in Jerusalem, and he's going to reign over the whole world. But we Assembly Adventists, like Abraham, we look for a city that has foundation, whose builder and maker is God. In that city, he will set up his kingdom. That's the city we look for. Not some place over in Israel. We look for a city that has foundation, whose builder and maker is God. And one day soon, he's going to come. So I hope somewhere in there you found something that touched your heart today. And I hope that from this day on, whenever you hear the Lord's Prayer or you repeat the Lord's Prayer, you will remember that this is God's will for all of us. The entire plan of salvation is here. In these few little verses that Jesus gave, he compacted it all in there. There's much more. There's lots more detail, but like the time wouldn't allow. It's an amazing study. I'm glad I started it. Thank you, Pastor Darrell, for asking me to come out. Should we have a closing prayer now, or are we going to sing a song? Let's sing a song and then we'll have a closing.
Thank you.
Let's bow our heads. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and always. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And do join us for luncheon downstairs. God bless you all.